I was lying face up in my chiropractor's office, and she told me the story of a patient that she had that she thought was really an amazing woman, and she actually had wanted to write the script herself. And I said, well, why don't we talk about it and see whether it's really a good idea? And it was a great idea. And as soon as I heard about it, I thought, this is a great movie, and it's a great role model for women.
She said, do you know Michael Schomburg? And I said, no, I don't. And she said, well, that's Danny DeVito's partner, and his wife is my friend. And she said, would you mind if I shared some of these stories with her? No, I'm very open. I talked to everyone. No, why not? And the next time I went in, she said, you know, I talked to Carla, and she'd like to meet you. Would you come over and meet her? And I said, sure.
She came to my house for the first interview in this is what she was wearing. It was her birthday, so I have to give her that. She had on spike heels, black spike heels, long tan legs, absolutely, you know, no stockings on, mini, black leather mini skirt, and a black leather vest. That was it. And she shows up at my front door, and I thought, this is quite something. And I looked at her, and one would think from the first impression, if you don't go any farther, that this girl's really out there. But she sat down, and this girl is so smart that I thought, this is a great girl. She's like a superhero.
I suppose if I had really thought this was gonna happen, I might not have done it. But Carla was very forthwith, very honest. She said, you know, a lot of times these things don't happen. You know, they can get put up on a shelf. And I just didn't really pay much mind. And it happened. I still don't believe it. I mean, people ask me all the time, and it's like, I still don't believe that it's happening.
Julia was involved with the project before I came on. They were looking for a director. And after I read the script, I certainly felt that even if she were not already attached, that she was really the only person I could imagine playing this part. It seemed to play to everything that she does well, and yet have a component that I hadn't seen her express before.
It's a great character to get to play. I mean, it's so complete. There's so many different levels of the personality and the character and the physicality of it and all of it, and the scenarios that I get to play within being that individual. That's a lot to be asked to do, so I was really eager to rise to that challenge.
When I met the real Erin Brockovich and talked to her about herself and the story that we were trying to portray, I found that she had a very similar energy to Julia. There's just an inherent charisma and a sort of a light in the eye that was very, very similar.
We had talked about the character so much, and he had spent so much time with her gathering information and shared so much of that with me, that he kept us apart really until she came to the set, which was about halfway through the movie. Which I think was really interesting, because ultimately I think it was wise that you're not imitating somebody. I think he didn't want that. He didn't want me to pretend to be this person. He wanted me to inhabit the concept of this person.
I wasn't standing there on the set watching Julia and thinking, well, you're not doing this right and you're not doing that right. I sat there and I watched this scene with her bouncing the baby on her leg and the little boy, Matthew, and Katie, and he rolled up that menu and went, poo, doo, you know, in the baby's face, and the baby's screaming. And I thought, I really did. I felt like my body was lifting. My hearing went into a tunnel, and I thought, I can't believe this. That was me. You know, the kids, and it's surreal. I just felt like I left my body. It's been, in some instances, very agonizing for me. Those are bad times that I thought were here, and I moved on, and they're in my face. They're back, and I'm looking at them and studying them, and I've shed a lot of tears, some because I was sad, some because I was happy. It's unbelievable. I think it would be unbelievable for anybody.
Sorry. Would you mind if I investigate this a little further?
Investigate what?
This real estate thing with the Jensens, the pro bono case.
Yeah.
See, yeah, because I just want to make sure that I'm understanding what I'm reading.
Yeah, sure.
You don't mind? Okay, great. Thanks.
One of the first documents I found was from a company hired by PG&E to research what was going on out there. And they had concluded that 90% of the chromate had already been removed via agricultural and domestic use. And reports within the water board still showed excessive amounts of chromium in their monitoring wells as I was researching it. And I thought, well, that doesn't make sense. What's happened to these people? So I would bring data every day like that back to Ed. So the law firm was just kind of letting me go. Ed believed I was onto something. I was working hard. I was bringing back information. It was making everybody else in the office mad.
The accounting department came in to see me and wanted me to terminate Erin because she wasn't obeying any of the rules. And I said, well, you forget about all those rules because she's not going to come in here every day just to plug in a computer because she's got to go to Hinckley, Barstow, UCLA. So forget the rules. They wanted to terminate her.
Bitches! I'm allergic to something. Jesus, there's a child on the bed.
Internally, there was some problems for me, definitely, when I would come back into the office. But I didn't pay much mind to that, and I just kept going and going and going.
And in fact, I have to laugh at this one. At one point, we had a memo in the office. I don't know that we still have it. I've been practicing for 39 years. You end up with a lot of memos. And the memo said you couldn't wear a skirt that was shorter than 4 inches above the knee. And Erin, particularly in those days, I would imagine she didn't have much of a wardrobe, would wear, I don't know whether you call them minis or micro minis, but they were pretty small, you know. So one day, one of the secretaries who was in charge of this came in with a ruler and measured how far her skirt was from the knee, and then came to me demanding that I tell Erin she had to wear longer skirts. I, of course, said no. I wasn't going there.
I admit, I don't know shit about shit, but I know the difference between right and wrong.
Lover's quarrel.
Oh, bite my ass, Krispy Kreme.
Films that are based on fact are kind of tricky animals because they're not documentaries, obviously. And yet you want to be as accurate as you can be within the guise of a piece of entertainment. And so I felt a lot of my work was familiarizing myself with Erin and Ed specifically, and the history of the case itself, and try and tilt the film as close as possible to what actually happened, without violating the sort of structure and rhythm and energy that the script had.
There's a scene in the movie where Albert Finney addresses the clients, and what happened in that scene is very realistic as to what actually happened that night at the firehouse. I'll never forget that night for the rest of my life, because when Erin and I arrived there, people were doing everything they could to avoid me. I mean, I couldn't gouge anybody's attention. And Erin kept saying they're making a noose. So the meeting started with real hostility. And if you can imagine this packed room, I mean, you couldn't breathe, and it was hot. We were all sweating, and Erin sat on the front row looking at me. She wouldn't look at him. And so I was up there for probably 2 hours explaining this, responding to questions. They're very hostile, but at the end of the meeting, all of them signed. Everybody signed for the binding arbitration.
The thing that was particularly
moving for me, playing it in that firehouse, I think it was in Hinckley, was that a lot of our extras in the audience we had were actual plaintiffs in the case. And at one point, Stephen kept the camera running, and a man in the audience started to talk about when he'd first had a problem with his kidney, and then he had to have one of his kidneys removed and the kind of treatment he was having. And I was wondering, how am I going to respond to this? This is all, you know, it was improvised, but he was just talking about his own particular case. And then gladly, luckily for me, towards the end of his statement, he said, so we have to get a decision quickly because I don't know how long I've got left. I don't know how ill I may become. And it was kind of disturbing and quite moving to realize that a lot of the people I was playing to and playing with, because obviously they were photographed, had suffered quite a lot.
I want you to think real hard about what your spine is worth, Mr. Walker, or what you might expect someone to pay you for your uterus, Miss Sanchez. Then you take out your calculator and you multiply that number by 100. Anything less than that is a waste of our time. By the way, we had that water brought in special for you folks. Came from a well in Hinckley.
Certainly, I don't think PG&E behaved well or honorably during the period portrayed and discussed in the film. At the same time, I wasn't out to make it worse than it was, mostly because I didn't need to.
It's hard to comprehend what these people were put through and just the amount of deception that went on. It's terrifying, really, because you think, well, if this happened here, where else is it happening? Where else are we as people of this country and of this world, I suppose, where are we being deceived?
It's important for people everywhere to trust their impressions of what's going on in their life. And then if they feel something strongly enough to go after it, and that in a case like this, where you've got a woman who really had no power and had no support, believed in her gut that something was wrong and that she felt it needed to be righted. And I think that's a really important message, that someone so powerless could do something so important.
Erin's had a very interesting life. And when she started working in the law firm, she was living in a very, very small place and very, very tight quarters. She had three children. Her child support was minimal, if any. And she was just trying very hard as a single mother to get by in life. And she has, in fact, there's no question that my peers and I all agree, she's by far the best toxic investigative research that we've ever known. She's just incredible at it.
For me, what it's about is that's as dirty as you can get. And there's no explanation and there's no excuse for a corporation that has as much money as these companies have and power and technology to look the other way. There's no excuse. And I hope that's a message that is conveyed strongly, because people don't seem to think about it until it happens to them. But it's happening to all of us.